Welcome to the January session of the Historic District Commission. My name is Richard Katz. I'm vice chairman. And the members of the commission are, to my right, George Melcher, alternate, who will be voting as a full member tonight.
Good evening.
Then John Wyckoff, commissioner.
Good evening.
William Gladhill, planning board representative.
Good evening.
And to my left is Nicholas Cracknell, new guy from the planning department, filling in for Roger Plum and Liz Good.
Good evening.
And then Tony Coviello, council representative.
Happy New Year.
Tracy Kozak, commissioner.
Hello.
And Joe Almeida, newly minted commissioner. Congratulations, Joe.
Thank you, sir. Good evening.
Okay. The first thing we have on the agenda tonight is election of officers for the year 2012. I'm going to open the board for nominations.
Mr. Katz, I would like to nominate yourself as the new chairman of the Historic District Commission.
Is there a second?
I think we don't need seconds for nominations, from what I
understand. We don't?
No.
Okay. Further nominations. Mr. Melcher.
Mr. Vice, I'd like to nominate Joe Almeida for chairman.
Are there any other nominations? Discussion?
I would just like to say I know that you have been a president of a neighborhood organization for a couple years. You've done a very good job as vice chair, taking over when needed, and you're certainly serious and always here, very good attendance, which I feel is important for the chairman. So I think that Mr. Katz would make an excellent chairperson.
Mr. Melcher.
Oh, all right. Can I ask a procedural question? How does the voting occur?
I will announce the first nomination, and then I think it'd probably be a good idea to poll go in line.
Okay.
How would that be?
Mm-hmm. And is it correct that a concurring vote of 5 is required?
I think
it's
a simple majority, isn't it? There's a five-four quorum. Unless you
actually, per the Historic District Commission Rules and Procedures, Article C.3, the concurring votes of 5 members in attendance at a meeting shall be necessary to elect officers.
Can I read that?
Yeah.
So that's five yes votes.
We might have to go back and forth a number of times, just like
yeah.
I'm buying.
Would anybody like me to read this?
Yeah.
Okay. Or you can read it, Trace. You brought it.
No.
All right. So Section 1 under the Historic District Commission Rules and Procedures, under Section C, I guess we'll start off with Section C2. Officers, commission members shall annually elect from its membership in January of each year a chair and vice chair. The vice chair, in the absence of the chair, shall have all the powers and duties of the chair as prescribed by state law. And in Section C3, the concurring votes of 5 members in attendance at a meeting shall be necessary to elect officers.
It's okay. Concurring.
That's a pretty big group. Well, I guess 5 of 9, if we're all in attendance.
Could I see that, please?
So it says.
Okay. It's getting late.
all right. It would appear that whoever will be elected chairman has to have 5 votes. Is that your interpretation?
Yeah, sounds like.
All right. Probably the way to do this, I think, would just be to start with Mr. Almeida.
You're going to do that to me?
Sure.
Can I have my discussion first?
Yeah, certainly.
Because I did think about this for a little bit, obviously.
This is, if you want, you could do secret. Just letting you know.
Got paper, just in case.
Do you want to do a secret ballot? It's never been done before.
We have discussion first.
Yeah. Well, sure.
Yeah, right here.
Discussion? So, why did I nominate Joe? Obviously, I know Joe. I've known Joe for quite some time, and we've all known Joe on the commission, at least all of us except for William, for a couple of years now. But I want to talk a little bit about, you know, the chairmanship as a whole, and it's not just showing up to the meetings. While I agree that is important, and obviously attendance would be of paramount importance for the chairman, but the chairman has other roles outside of just running the meeting. We can talk about the meeting and the chairman's roles at the meeting. Certainly the chairman is supposed to be a presence of objectivity and procedure, and ensure the integrity of procedure at the meetings. Of course, facilitate conversation and direct conversation, very much as the previous chair did. She did a wonderful job of facilitating conversation, not allowing personal opinion or emotion to bleed into the objectivity of the chair. That's a leadership position. It's not a position of opinion or passion. But beyond the leadership role of the commission and session, there's also the representation and diplomacy of the position outside of the quorum. You know, the mayor just told us just last month when we had our joint work session with three commissions and the city council, he is not going to go forward with the Blue Ribbon Commission to figure out how to reconcile differences that we have, what I'd call stovepipe differences, you know, specific concerns that don't align between the three commissions, the Economic Development Commission, the Planning Board, and the Historic District Commission. So we have to work it out on our own. and that's the chair. The chair represents the commission. The chair is the face of the commission. The chair is the public face of the commission. The chair is the bureaucratic voice of the commission when working with the chairs of the other commissions. So certainly a diplomacy and ability to work with others is a requirement. And Joe's a knowledgeable person. There's no question about it. But I nominate Joe not based on his knowledge, but based on his ability to work with others. He knows a lot of folks across all of our both volunteer and staff government. Works very well with them. As we move forward, that's what we need. We need somebody who can work with the other commissions. Same thing as the media draws attention. We're going to have a lot more pressure coming at us from the northern tier as well as beyond the northern tier. Again, the face and the voice of the commission has to be an objective and intelligent voice that can clearly articulate our concerns, our opinion as a body, you know, again, without injecting opinion or personal opinion or any type of passion. That's very important. And I mean, Joe's embodied that ever since he's been on the commission, at least ever since I've been on this commission.
I'd like to address those comments. In 1996, I was elected president of the Lafayette Park Neighborhood Association, and I held that post for 2 years. The association was formed to prevent the Lafayette School from being turned into for-profit condominiums or some other use. And there was a request for proposals that was published, and the people came running. So the association had time at that time, within a short period of time, had 80 members in our phone list. We had, for 2 years, a monthly newsletter, which I and Sam McLeod and Nancy Sell wrote and published, and also delivered them. In 1998, I was appointed as an alternate. Also at that time, I was a member of the steering committee of the All Neighborhood Groups. And in 1998, I was appointed as an alternate to the Historic District Commission. Ray Bowles sort of thought it wasn't a great idea for me to continue with the Neighborhood Association and being on a Historic District Commission. I thought that was probably a good observation on his part. At this time, there was also a movement interest in forming a dog owners association, because there's no place you could take your dog, run it off leash. The first meeting was held in the old Red Cross room. I chaired that meeting, and we elected officers. I was not an officer. I felt other people should get their feet wet in this situation, and it worked out well. We worked with Mayor Sorrell, getting the dog park, getting it started, and it's pretty much been a real success. And I trudged on as an alternate for 7 years. And at that time, I was asked to be on Mayor Marchand's Committee on Term Limits. Tony, all right? And we worked well together. We got a lot done, obviously. So I want to go back to the Neighborhood Association. This was a hot button item. I had reporters calling me probably a minimum of once a week, maybe more. I can honestly say that I've had a couple of close occurrences. I never sent anything to a reporter that I had to apologize for, retract, or correct. So I can think on my feet for the most part.
Should we vote?
There you have it, folks.
Okay.
So, further discussion.
Just to be clear, because I appreciate your input, and this is not a rejection of you. I think we all recognize both your experience and your dedication to the city as well as to this commission. Certainly recognized. But you're also a very passionate vote. You're a very passionate vote. You bring a lot of passion in your discussion, and you bring a lot of knowledge to the table. And when you weigh in on an issue, it moves people. People respond to it. If you're the chair, Richard, I'm gonna be honest with you. I feel like that position, the bureaucratic constraints, the rigidity of your position, the objectivity that's required in as the chair would severely constrain your ability to share your opinion on it.
I don't want to interrupt. I'm well aware of the difference in the job of being a commissioner and being chair, and it's essentially, with the experience I've had with it, the few times. It's pretty much a full-time thing, just keeping the meeting going. If I enter into any of these discussions, it will be at the end. I am not going to make any motions, all right? I just want to run it and make sure it's run efficiently, with transparency, and with civility, as far as the applicants are concerned.
And that's important, but you're talking about the process of the meeting itself, and I agree that's great, but moving again beyond just having assembly as a quorum, you know, meeting once a month or twice a month, the chair has to exercise that same objectivity in all of its capacity. That includes dealing with members of staff and other volunteer boards, not just in session but also outside of session, behind the scenes, right?
I don't see where this is going. Could we vote? Excuse me for interrupting. I just don't see this, that we need to have this discussion.
Does the other nominee want to talk? I don't.
Yeah.
Well,
embarrassing.
Well, let me say this. This is not a situation that I asked for or that I seeked. I did have a conversation with an individual on this board about my desire to be chair, and obviously it would be a great honor, and I would accept it. It is not something that I went out looking for. However, I do think it's important that the commissioners simply vote for whom they want to be chair. I'd be lying to you if I were to say that I was not interested in that seat. It is something that I'm obviously would be thrilled to do, and I would bring dedication and energy to it. So I don't want to turn this into an election season or bring out resumes. I just want to say that I'm honored to be nominated, and I certainly would accept the chair if it were the wishes of the rest of the commission. I'll leave it at that. And if not, I would be fine with that as well, honestly. So,
secret ballot.
I just wanted to mention a couple of things about the position of chair, because I really wasn't sure of the objective points upon which we're to be making our decisions. And so I turn to Robert's Rules of Orders and definition of the chair. And I just want to point out a couple of things that Robert mentions. And I'm not gearing this towards anyone in particular or against anyone in particular. I just say this for whoever we go with. Chair, if the chairman has the appearance of being partisan, he loses his ability to control those who are on the opposite side. So that one who expects to take an active part in debate should never accept the chair. Should be an example of courtesy and never forget that to control others, it is necessary to control oneself. And it goes on to say that, as I think Richard mentioned, the chair is really a moderator more than a debater, so to speak. So just to make sure everyone realizes that it is a very different role and action for whoever changes from a commissioner to a chair, that you may not have the freedom to debate along the whole way as you have had before, and it's a very different role to moderate the group in a neutral aspect. So that's all.
Thank you.
Secret ballot.
20 passed.
That's not necessary for me.
Sure.
Okay,
sure.
Okay, we'll poll the commission, starting with Mr. Almeida.
Secret. I'm sorry, you're asking for a secret ballot? Is that what I heard?
Well, it seems that there was...
Is this a poll for a secret ballot?
Is there a poll for a secret ballot?
It seems like the most humane way to solve this, honestly. To be honest with you, we're getting into a very uncomfortable...
Let's just do secret ballot.
Yeah. Okay.
Well, we have our yellow paper.
That's right.
I would use those.
Okay, let's use these little rather than their stickies.
So I need four.
These official.
So done by Price Waterhouse.
And we'll give them to Liz.
This is getting to be relatively exciting.
We pass them down?
Yeah. And fold them over.
Oh. I did a secret on my secret ballot, but there you go.
For Joe and three for Richard.
Well, now what do we do? Do it again?
85.
What do we do now?
We have to reconsider.
And revote.
Is this business that could be postponed to another meeting, or must we elect a chair tonight? I assume we're self-governing. If we wanted to put this off to another meeting, it is an option, or is it an option? I'm asking the question.
I don't know. This is a short meeting.
Or we could table it to the end of the meeting to help these folks get on with their.
Why don't we do that?
Motion to table the or postpone this to the end of the meeting.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion to postpone is carried. Okay. We have before us a possible meeting with the Department of Transportation representatives. Now, it's my understanding, Liz, you said that they request a meeting with us?
Well, if you recall, Chairman Dyka sent a letter in December, and this was in response to that letter, that they would be willing to come and have a meeting with you all, explain the project. So it's up to you as to whether you'd like to have that meeting. You also received an email about the open house that's coming up January 12th.
Okay.
That the Department of Transportation is doing right here at City Hall. It's an open house where the public can come and ask questions. And
any thoughts?
The meeting would be a presentation to us by the DOT, or are we simply participants in a greater meeting?
It's my understanding that they would come and explain the project to you, and you just have conversation with you. But things are moving quickly with the bridge closure and that sort of thing.
Tony.
It's my impression that this project is a freight train, and that it is moving forward. While I appreciate the effort to discussion, it'll be a one-way conversation. There's no redesigning of this bridge that's going to occur. I would think that we should just show up to the other meeting if we're interested in learning about it. I think just asking them to come down to give us an individual explanation might be unnecessary. It's up to the commission, obviously, but they're not changing the design for us.
Any other thoughts?
No, I think we discussed this last month, and we came to the same conclusion as a commission. That a personal audience with HDC wouldn't be of any value to us or the project.
I would have appreciated this meeting a year ago.
Yeah, let's repeat what we said last time. It's not a matter of not having a care about the design of the bridge, just for the general public. But we talked about, we recognize the fact that the design for the bridge is complete, and if we were to raise our hand at this point, and we have had opportunity as members of the public to comment and to even review plans online, it's when people criticize our work at the 11th hour after something is done, we don't appreciate it. So I think that was kind of the conclusion we came to last time. However, on a Commissioner Katz, you had talked about there might be some elements, for example, the plaques. There could, in fact, be some small items that are still up for discussion, and perhaps that might be part of their presentation. I don't know, but if that's true, then I don't know if it's something that we feel would have a huge impact on the historic district or not. But.
Well, I think that probably if there is some opinion that that this might be helpful, someone should offer a motion and see how it flies.
I would move to not accept their invite for the meeting. I think
Commissioner Coviello hit it on the head, that if we did have comments on, we could simply, as members of the public, go to any number of the hearings or the presentations that they invite the public to. I'm sorry, go ahead.
I'll second that.
I wonder if, I guess I'll add on to that, if I could amend it, is to send a letter of thank you for the option.
That's a great idea.
And, we'll just attend the public meeting, those of us who are interested.
Sure.
Is that agreeable?
Absolutely.
Thanks.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
Okay, with the letter.
Okay. Old business, approval of meetings, November 9th, 2011.
I move we approve those minutes.
Second.
Second, did you get a second?
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
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 All right.
And public hearing one. Petition of Strawberry Bank, Inc., owner for property located at 80 Atkinson Street, where permission is requested to allow exterior renovations to an existing structure, replace one window as per plans on file in the planning department. Said property is shown on Assessor Plan 104 as Lot 7 and lies within mixed residential, office, and historic districts. Who is speaking to this application?
My name is Rodney Rowland. I'm Director of Facilities and Special Projects at Strawberry Bank. Pretty simple and straightforward. At some point in the past, long before there was a historic district commission, I'm sure, a non-conforming window was placed in the second floor of the building. You can see that in the in one of the images and then from one of the distant shots as well. We would like to replace that window with a conforming true divided light window that we would make at Strawberry Bank to match all of the other windows on the second floor of this building. That's it.
Questions for the applicant?
No.
No questions. Is there anyone in the audience wishing to speak to, for, or against this application? I'll repeat again. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against? Seeing no one rise, I wait a motion.
Mr. Vice Chairman, I move that we grant a certificate of appropriateness as presented.
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All right.
The motion passes. You have your approval.
I'm fine.
Did he? Dr. Liz, mm-hmm. What do we do about processing this approval? Yeah. I mean, we usually have
signature or something.
Oh, right here. Yeah.
Oh. This is Roger's chair.
That's right. So.
Is it?
Yeah. Richard will sign on that line.
Okay. We're new at this. So
there,
you sign what it says. Thank you.
Where does it say?
I sign.
Wow. Did I put the vote where?
Okay.
That's my screening right there.
The next petition is petition of Strawberry Bank, Inc., owner for property located 7274 Jefferson Street, wherein permission is requested to allow new freestanding structures, install fencing, install AC condenser, and relocate existing transformer. As for plans on file in the planning department, said property is shown on Assessor Plan 104, is Lot 7, and lies within mixed residential, office, and historic districts.
That would be me again. On the first page of my of the submissions. You'll see a plot plan done by our architect, and this shows, superimposed on this plan is the 1890 Sanborn map, and those are all the dotted lines. What we want to do is try to bring a sense of urban density back to this area by erecting a fence on the 1890 lot lines, as shown on the Sanborn map. These will really delineate the yards, the urban work yards, that the three structures, the Yetton House, the Wynn House, and the Yetton Walsh House originally had, rather just being an open, uninterpreted space. We're purposely, obviously, avoiding that dashed line, which is where another structure was once located, and it had its little shed, which you can see delineated on there as well. So that's the proposal is the fence, which I've written on the plan for you. Now, that fence does a couple of things. Not only does it bring back the urban density sort of image in those urban work yards, but it also helps us find a way to shroud some of the modern necessities that we need to put in. One of those things on the application is a transformer. Currently located in the Aldrich Garden is a transformer that powers half of our site. PSNH has indicated that needs to be replaced and is helping us financially to do that, but we need to get it out of the garden. And so we propose to put it within this new fenced-in area with its own shroud, another fence, so that it's equally, you know, very considerably hidden. That will contain the transformer and the meter banks that we need for most of the buildings that you see in this plot plan. Also behind this area would be a future ramp. You can see it marked there, future ramp. It's not part of the proposal because we're not ready to design that ramp, but eventually we're going to want to have handicap accessibility to the first floors of the Yetton House and the Wynn House for a proposed decorative arts exhibit gallery. That ramp would give people access, and the proposed AC condenser would help us control the humidity as required for objects that would be on display in that facility. So that basically is the application. Just going through the various sheets that I've given you, page two is a detail of all of the fencing. It's your typical Portsmouth solid board fencing with a decorative custom-made cap. We've got examples of it all over the grounds already. You can see one of those on the next page. It's a typical 2x4 frame, 4x4 post, 1x solid board fence. And then the proposed area of the fence is depicted in these various pictures. It's the area, as I've mentioned, between the Yetton House, the Wynn House, and the Yetton Walsh House. And then in that upper picture, you also see the existing transformer as it appears in the Aldrich Garden. It's fairly important for us to get it out of the garden. If we tried to replace that at this point, we'd probably do more damage to the now mature landscaping that has grown up around this transformer since it was put in. So by actually just moving it somewhere else, we do protect the landscape as well. Giving you some hardware details for hinges on the gates. And then another close-up of the transformer in its existing location with some dimensions. Picture of a typical meter bank that will be up next to the transformer behind the fencing. And then specifications as to the York AC condensing unit.
Questions for the applicant?
I have a question. This meter bank, is this the size that it's going to be, or is it going to have many meters?
It will have 4 meters.
Oh, just four, yeah.
Tony? Do you have these air conditioning units elsewhere on the property?
We do. The Studley's Tavern has them. The Tyco Visitor Center has them. The Carter Collection Center has them. That's all I could think of off the top of my head.
Further questions?
Is the 6-foot height of the fence continuous everywhere, or does it drop down in areas?
No.
And the gates are the same as well?
Yep.
Any further questions? Is there anyone in the audience wishing to speak to, for, or against this application? I'll repeat that. Anyone in the audience wishing to speak to, for, or against? Seeing no one rise, I declare the public hearing closed, and I await a motion.
I move we grant the certificate of appropriateness.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Chair votes aye.
Can we do discussion? I'm sorry. We don't have a discussion period?
After the motion.
We can roll that back. You're right.
Sorry.
Mr. Wyckoff? You voted first.
Oh,
are you
discussion?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, the fence is appropriate to the site, and it's certainly not detrimental to any properties, and it makes a lot of sense in Strawberry Bank to have an appropriate historic fence.
Further discussion? All right, we'll try again. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Chair votes aye. You have your approval.
Yes.
We're ready this time.
Thank you for being easy.
Now we have the petition of Linda Preble McVeigh and John Frank McVeigh, owners for property located at 42 Hunking Street, wherein permission is requested to allow new construction to an existing structure, install railings as per plans on file in the Planning Department. Said property is shown on Assessor Plan 102 as Lot 8 and lies within General Residence B and Historic District. Who is speaking to this application?
Hi, I'm John McVeigh, and I reside at 42 Hunking Street. Mm-hmm. And I'm here tonight to get approval for the railing for our front stairs. And the concern of this is for safety reasons. My wife just recently had knee surgery and recently fell off in that ice storm, fell off the stairs. So that's our main concern. And what we did is we contacted Peter Happney to come and talk to us about suggestions in relation to what type of railing we should have on our front steps. Now, our front steps don't face the street. They face our yard. And you'll see in the packet that I've included the diagram and the suggestions that Peter gave to us, which we like. And also, I've included pictures, and there's a picture of our front stairs so you get an idea of what that looks like. And I've also enclosed the identical railings that Peter has suggested, which we like. One which is on Hunking Street, and then another one which is down at the corner of Marcy and Hunking Street. And there's also one at on Gate Street. And the railing would be identical to those railings.
Questions for the applicant?
I'm sorry?
Not necessarily a question, just a comment, that, just to expedite this. Obviously, we see many of these railings in the South End and throughout Portsmouth done by a local artist. Just a fantastic design, and I can't imagine any opposition to this at all. It's really nice, would be a nice addition to the house. I wish it would be seen from the street.
Further questions? Is there anyone in the audience wishing to speak to, for, against this application? Anyone in the audience wishing to speak to, for, or against? I declare the public meeting closed, and I await a motion.
Vice Chairman, I move that we grant a certificate of appropriateness as presented.
Second?
Second.
Discussion?
Just to quickly repeat what I said, very appropriate iron railing, kind of becoming the Portsmouth standard. Beautiful design. Simple as that.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Chair votes aye. You have your approval.
Thank you.
You've already signed. You're all set.
I'm sorry?
You've already signed, so you're all set.
In advance. Almost 8 o'clock. Come on. Let's get it.
Wow. Now we have a work session for requested by General Porter Condominium Association, owner for property located at 32 Livermore Street, where permission is requested to allow new construction to an existing structure, rebuild rear dormer and allow exterior renovations to an existing structure, add period shutters and allow new freestanding structures, add fence posts and fencing, change driveway, column details. Said property is shown on Assessor Plan 109 as Lot 20 and lies within the General Residence B and Historic District. We adjourn to the table.
I'll be recusing myself from this application.
Okay.
Great, I love it when there's research provided.
Yeah, there's quite a history to this building. There's some packets prepared.
Mr. Chamberlain strikes again. Chamberlain's photograph.
So this property, if you're not familiar, sits and overlooks Haven Park. It is the General Porter House next to the Livermore House on Livermore Street. And do you want me to give you an overview of the property or just go through point by point? It's a condominium, and the association is in the process of doing multiple repairs around the property, from masonry to siding to roof repairs that needed to be done. And they've engaged Portsmouth builders to make repairs to, starting with the cedar roof on the front portion of the lower section of the front gambrel. So the first item that's being requested is that the upper slope of the gambrel was an asphalt roof, and at some point within the last 10 or 15 years it was a discount shingle that was just placed on top of asphalt that was there before. It was in very poor condition, so that's been removed. The decking's been replaced. And the first item that the condominium association is requesting is to change that upper slope of the gambrel back to a cedar roof. So that's point one that they're asking.
Are you changing it from cedar to asphalt or from asphalt to cedar?
There, on a gambrel, there's two pitches on the front portion. The lower portion was cedar and has been replaced with cedar.
So today it is cedar. Yep.
It is and has been. So, and then the upper slope was asphalt that has been removed. And so in that process, we were intending to put asphalt back. However, there's been a request by the condominium association to return that to a cedar roof.
Okay, because line one says cedar to asphalt.
Right.
So that's a typo.
Okay, just make sure.
Thank you.
So this is currently tar paper or what?
It's ice and water at the moment.
It's ice and water. Boy, they're going to need ice and water for cedar shingles up there.
At that slope?
Yeah, you do use cedar breathing material underneath.
The cedar breather was used, the 5/8 taper sawn, layer of tar paper in between.
I'm sure it was originally wooden shakes as well. It's still got
tested. It's my experience, wooden shakes, you get 10 years out of them now, you're lucky.
Well, what's been replaced with this front section is a western red cedar 5/8 taper sawn, so
that's a little thicker.
It's considerably. I think part of the reason why this was prematurely failed was that I think it's white cedar.
Siding shingles.
Most likely, and if you look around town, as I did the research for this one, every north-facing cedar gambrel is almost every single one of them is covered with moss. So that's request number one, that the owners are requesting.
Any further thoughts on this particular aspect?
I have a thought on that particular aspect would be when capping this, that the cap be covered with a zinc metal, and that will kill the moss. It's a very common, it was very common 100 years ago. A lot of roofers have forgotten it. But I don't know what it is about the zinc, but it does kill moss and doesn't allow mildew or anything to grow.
That's a good point. It was done on a house on Gardner Street a couple years ago, and boy, it has been effective.
It's amazing.
It's amazing. It does work.
Yeah, there's a property in the zinc. I'm familiar with that, but we'll certainly present that to the owner.
What does it do to the gardens?
It poisons everything. Little children.
Entire yard turns brown.
Turns all the flowers.
Would there be any objections to changing the roof from an asphalt to a cedar?
I think it's a wonderful change.
Cedar's good. Cedar's good.
Okay. The next point would be the fence post detail. So on the main picture that you have here, to the left side of the house is the driveway, and years ago there existed, and it's not in this photograph, but years ago there was a matching post and detail at the left side of the driveway with a small wooden fence that went down alongside the driveway, much like the solid wooden fencing that you find around Strawberry Bank. There is a difficult to see, but there is a photograph of that post that exists right here in this photograph. And so several years ago, that post was struck by a plow or a vehicle at some point in time, and it was never replaced. So the request is to replace that post with, and I don't have copies of this for everyone to hand out tonight, but I do have a couple that can be seen. That's the detail of the existing posts.
What would that material be?
Probably cedar, but
all wood versus a composite product?
Well, would there be any objection to a composite product if it looked historically accurate compared to the others?
I think we saw a beautiful reproduction of in front of the Mark Wentworth home of a very ornate fence out of a composite material. Remember that a couple years ago? And it's personally, I think it's very convincing.
Yeah.
Yeah, but when it's field painted, it's very difficult to tell. And there again, with new products, this Windsor pine, unfortunately, that a lot of people been using, myself included, representative uses of it. I'm thinking on the backside of State Street condos on Court Street and stuff, and these buildings are only 3 or 4 years old, and they are rotted.
Right. There are multiple class actions going on.
Well, there ought to be.
On the fence, I don't see an issue myself with it. The house is different. The house is a pedigree I would probably never want to see composite on, but the fence.
Okay.
Moving right along.
Moving right along, since there are a lot of other points. So if there are no objections to the first three. The driveway side of the house, which is where we have a significant portion of the requests going on, or the focus of the request, we'd like to replace all of those upper windows, the second and third floor, with a window that has already met with approval by the Historic District for a previous remodeling project on the back of the house. It's a Marvin wood window. There was an addition that was a remodel that was done on the back side of the house, so we would replace those in time with the board's approval. And there is a there's an odd window up on the top right side of that facade that's an 8/8 window, and that would like to replace with a 6/6 to match the same floor window.
You're showing, on your rendering, you're showing 9/9.
And that would be a cut and paste. So being the work session, we were rushing to fit a lot of the items in.
Yep.
We would make a full documented request as part of the formal.
Are we sure about the this being an odd window and not something that was unique and original to the building? Do any of the graphics show?
Well, in this window, in this picture, you can see that there is something that's different there, but it's not clear enough to find out why. I think it was an oddball back then.
It's like a shutter's half closed on it.
Well, I think it's actually two windows there, and that somebody shortened it up. There are pictures at the library that show the building with 2/2 windows, much like 24 Marcy Street. The windows that are in here now are not original.
Yeah, you know what you're seeing here? You're seeing the shutters completely closed on these two windows, completely closed over the sash, and this window having one shutter closed. Those dark rectangles are the shutters, not the windows. But I don't know, something I'd hate to, if that window were in fact original and to the house.
I agree.
I'd hate to see it.
Can you pass that around?
Sure.
So what you're saying is that all of these windows, the 9/6s and on this building, have all been replaced with single pane glass windows, but recently.
Right.
40 years ago.
It was suggested to me that these are Brosco windows.
Unfortunately, that was just about the only distributor you could order anything from. You know, it was especially single pane glass, you know, true divided light windows.
Joe, looking at the picture, I have to agree with your assessment that this window does look like it appeared back around 1900. I don't know how further back it was, but at least it was over 100 years ago.
It looks like you have a lot more discussion on this side.
We do.
So I'm wondering if we, as a whole, look at the entire elevation.
Sure.
Rather than.
This is probably the oldest photograph you're going to find, because this is Gurney's book. 1900 or so.
Someone would be further clarified with a sidewalk, which I assume we're going to, you know, for something for this magnitude, we would have anyway for this property.
Sure. So, yeah, I mean, this window in particular is odd. You know, when it became odd or irregular, I'm not sure if anybody knows or can suggest how it came to be. I'm all ears.
Well, a house of this size, believe it or not, these windows could be the odd ones out. This could have been the original configuration. Does the inside give you any clues that the casings are the...
That's the only way we could tell.
Well, it's hard to say. The condo docks back from the 80s, all of the front dormers are non-original. So this is a front bedroom space, and this is a rear bedroom space. And there are pictures, including this one, that, you know, show that there are no dormers on the front portion of the house.
It's a tough one. A house of this pedigree and quality on probably the finest house street in town. This would be a tough one to accept any real changes.
Well, I mean, is the board's job to make sure that the changes are appropriate to the neighborhood, or is it the preservation of every piece of wood from the original construction, which
both,
you know,
both.
A 300-year-old house?
Yeah, both. I think it's a fine balance, weighing back and forth. Because, like you said, if you change a piece, well, you keep changing it piece by piece by piece, well, eventually you lose the original and the historic nature.
Well, there are many things that are being requested to bring it back to some of its original status. So, yes, to Joe's point, there is a request to improve a portion of the back of the house, which affects this left side elevation, which faces Pleasant Street. There's a rendering and a picture of the back of the house showing the existing dormer right now, which...
You're speaking of this,
Yes, there's another. This photograph that's below there shows the construction at the back. So this dormer certainly wasn't original. Is of very poor construction, including the entire roof assembly, and it's actually caving into the roof line. There's been a report by John Merkel from TMS, as well as Bill Cipino, who have come in and analyzed what's going on, and they can only determine so far without opening things up as to how far things continue to deteriorate there.
But certainly, I'm trying to understand the point you're trying to make here, because I mean, this is an appropriate dormer for the house that it's just a matter of this particular one perhaps is rotted because of its quality of construction, or
that's a part of it. So there's a column that's been placed underneath it to shore that up, and then a beam put in the floor below to shore that up.
Okay.
There are I think precedents for making a change that's being requested here for this back portion of the gambrel that doesn't quite fit the symmetry of the other portions of the gambrel. The John Paul Jones house has a shed dormer which descends from the upper plane of the back of that property. The Salter house that the Chinberg is building right now has a shed dormer that faces Saunders. That's a very similar construction.
Could I ask a question about this on your site plan? Is this a straight plane or is this canting back, which is a very common detail on this?
Well,
elongated gambrel.
Right. The original condo docks don't have anything but a front elevation.
But on these plans you have here, is this plane straight, or does a portion of this start to turn back?
I'm not quite sure.
Did I see the same plan? Or the actual floor plan, Because this particular elevation, this is something that we don't have very many of in Portsmouth. This elongated gambrel is certainly a very traditional and historic form. Newburyport has several of them. We don't have many of them. And the loss of that roofline, I think, would be a terrible thing to lose. This is not something that was added. I believe this is original.
Yeah, I really think that, you know, a sidewalk is going to be necessary. I mean, if they don't want to have the entire HDC go through, then I would suggest that one or two of us could, make an appointment, gain entry, and look for ourselves at the window in question on the driveway side, and this construction of this addition here to see if this is indeed something that was constructed with the house. There again, if the trim is the casings on the inside are similar and to what's existing in the older portions, and you can identify it as such, it makes a strong case that this thing should be preserved. Just a thought.
Mm-hmm. So one of the questions would be, if this roof line were essential, but the dormer were allowed to be constructed, could that be expanded upon so that we could keep this roof line but reconstruct this dormer, which should be a photograph which is available in all of your packets? Could this be reconstructed in a manner which would, again, it exists now, it never was historic, if you used the precedent of these not being original either?
I don't quite understand the question.
So are you saying to reconfigure that gable dormer as a shed that's smaller?
Something more usable for the occupants of the inside space than what it is now.
There again, it's. I think that I know that these front dormers obviously were constructed in the 80s whenever this was condoized. And it would be a simple comparison to look at these three back ones and see if they are old or are they similarly constructed as the new ones. They're new, then there's no great loss to changing them. It might be difficult to do that without drastically changing this antique roof line that is existing here.
The dormers that were added in the 80s,
on the front,
are incredibly well done, aren't they? I mean, we would love for all our new dormers to look like that.
Yeah.
If that is a newer contemporary. Yeah. Addition, but when I look at this photograph, I'm seeing a clue to what we've seen before, and what we've allowed times before is a double dormer that's kind of connected on a plane set back a bit further, so it doesn't appear to be a shed. It's certainly more complicated to construct.
Yeah.
But we have seen that and approved it before. I just put that out there as a. And staying away from that roof edge.
I would agree that a setback from that historic edge is important to maintain that silhouette. But I also want to point out that, as far as I know, these small gable dormers were not terribly common on the backs of buildings. People didn't put all their money on the back of their building. If they needed a dormer, if they did, it would be a simpler form, not more of a shed.
Right.
And I think these actually look really bizarre. I'd be very surprised if they're original.
You all have more experience than I do, but I'm 99% certain that they were constructed at the same time as the dormers at the front of the building, as part of the condo conversion. Certainly the windows would dictate that, and the interior furnishings, and for what you can determine from the roofline from these plans, there were no provisions or changes there.
Of course, it was a very fine home,
and it is. It is, and we're trying to bring it back as much as possible with what's in reach to do that.
Can you see the water from those back dormers? I'm just wondering. I mean, historically, if who owned the house was even a ship captain or something.
But the house, to give you a little bit of background information, the house has been moved. Moved twice. It did face the South Mill Pond water at some point in time. But it was moved out of Haven Park to its present location now. So there, 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 there. reluctantly share another rendering that was put forth as being complicated to build and in flash and create as a possible alternative to the existing dormer now.
Well, I would just reiterate that I think that we need to look at some of these windows on the inside. On point number three, you seem to have jumped ahead here. And on number three, I'm interested in these windows. Is it not Pella? What are they?
Marvin.
Marvin windows. Are these replacement windows?
Well,
or are you intending on ripping all of these frames out? These four frames?
Yet to be determined, but most likely replacement windows. If you see these windows, which were approved by HDC, I think, 2 years ago, these windows are all the same Marvins that are being requested.
Right. But this whole addition here on the back was built as part of the condominium construction, and these windows consolidated what was more of an awkward windows that were placed in the 80s, but to jump on these four windows up here on the side of this house, you need to ask us that. And
well, that's what I'm here for.
Yeah. Well, I would say that, it's you're taking it very casually, and I don't feel that it's a casual.
I'm sorry. What's casual about that? I mean, this is a work
session,
right?
Casual, the fact that you didn't actually go into any detail about what you're doing. You just said that, we're going to change some windows here. What are we doing? So you're not, and I asked you if these were replacement windows, and you...
I refer to
be
what
determined.
Right, and yeah. Correct me if I'm wrong, but isn't a work session to present this?
That's exactly
and,
why
and to
I'm
get
speaking.
You the feedback. Right, so
that's why I'm speaking to you the way that I'm speaking. I'm asking you, are these replacement windows?
Well, I don't. There's nothing casual about my time and your time to be here. So,
okay, there's three. So now we're on four, replacing shutters.
Well, no, let's not skip ahead. If you want to dwell on the windows, I'm glad to do so. So we'd like to do the most appropriate, thermally efficient product that the historic district would allow us to do. The windows on the second floor, the sills are completely rotted out.
Right.
So
they need to be repaired.
Is that the requirement of the HDC, or it is...
It's not a requirement.
Thank you.
What you would do is you propose to us, and we do it. So it goes back to what we talked about earlier, having a sidewalk. But that is original, and of course, with wood windows, including the casings and the sill and the framing, it could be very rotten to the naked eye. In fact, still completely refurbished in place. And the same thing with energy improvements. You can restore an original window, and then put an interior storm or other ideas to get the same thermal efficiency, quote unquote, that you get from whatever Marvin. So it goes back to we look at the house, the character defining features, the integrity, and if these are original, then we would probably lean towards to get preservation and restoration over replacement.
And certainly that would be,
I guess what John is trying to say, we don't know enough here. You're asking us which way.
I'm not looking for an approval tonight.
I know.
I'm just looking for.
You're trying to get an idea of which way we would tend.
Right.
We can't tell you. We can't give you enough of that until we see more than we see in the pictures.
Sure. Okay.
Have we resolved that particular aspect?
I think so.
Okay. Good. So my. On my list, the other point on that side of the building is that the shutters that are there now are Home Depot stick-on, screw-to-the-wall shutters, would like to replace those with a workable wood shutter with an appropriate catch that would match the front of the building.
Let's take a moment to just, there are some amazingly great changes you're proposing here. I just want to, I want to try to get the meeting back on a positive note, because these are, the fact that you're asking to put wood shakes on, operable shutters, you know, this is all really good stuff. So I don't like the way that, you know, I don't want you to feel like we're bugging you here. Obviously, this is an incredibly special house in an incredibly special spot. You recognize that, which is why we're being so detailed.
Most of
these changes here, we're going to be cheering as you know.
And that's great. But these windows, through a course of events, have deteriorated to the point where action needs to be taken of whatever nature, whether or not it's restoration, replacement, new construction. Something's got to be done, and there's a certain level of urgency because they're actively leaking. Through changes at the property, there's a level of urgency that
I think we beat the window thing to death. I think both Commissioner Wyckoff and Melcher have said it. We need to see them. We sure. Might have an original window from General Porter himself. You know, original. We just don't know. So there might be some that are very special and others. That's all.
I mean, but that's the. I don't have as much experience as all of you, but I've got pictures of all the windows being 2/2. I can assure you, there's nothing original about these. I'm not asking you to give me a blanket recommendation. I know, and hopefully over time, you know that if I tell you that the windows aren't original, you'll understand. But anyways, I would welcome the site visit. And so how does that process work? We've done one before.
You have to request it.
But I'm just thinking in terms of the timing, does it get requested at this meeting, or is there some other process? And then what is the timing that...
You're going to have to call with Liz on that. Okay. She can schedule. But it's probably before the next, if you're going to be back for the February meeting, we'll one way or another get it in before that.
Before them, which is, I'm just trying to think of the sequencing and
sure.
timing. Okay, so we never finished sort of the change of roof line, and so I hear you loud and clear that you'd like to keep the this
elongated gambrel.
There are precedents. I don't know the name of the house. I'm sorry I didn't get to ask Rodney, but there's a yellow or mustard-colored house at the corner of Court Street, which is part of Strawberry Bank, that was just repainted, and that has
the
a
Oracle House.
Chase House.
It's at the opposite end. The Chase House.
Of Washington Street and Court.
And that has the and it's almost straight.
Another very common roofline.
Which would there be an objection to that sort of correction to?
Well, what do you call a correction? I personally would call it. Well, if you're looking for a consensus, I'd say I'd object to it.
Okay.
But I'm just trying to give you the information looking for. Anyone else want to jump in?
I'm thinking that if this is an original roof line of this house, that I think it should be maintained also. Whether or not it can be repaired, or, you know, if you need to take it apart, you know, to repair it, that could be.
It's probably a discussion for another time or place, but, you know, if it was wrong to begin with, I wonder, you know, what point? What's that?
Philosophical.
No, but I mean, it's there are certain structural things that are happening in that roof line, in the in the floors below that are suspect.
Let me, if I could throw this in, let me try to help you out with this. The even if it's not original, you know, we need to also look at what's appropriate.
Right.
I think you'd be hard pressed to find something more appropriate than that roof line. This certainly, if we're trying to simply go by the rules of the ordinance, if we had to judge this as appropriate versus that, this would definitely be a more appropriate what exists right now. So I just want to be clear. I personally, as one voting member, would, even if that were not an original detail to this house, that is perfectly appropriate for that house.
Okay. So on to other things. Duly noted. The photograph of the back of the property showing the decks and railings, none of this would have been appropriate or original. So there is a request to take this little entry porch area and just slide this railing in line with this window to give a little bit more standing walking entry room here.
So they can see that.
Yeah. Okay. One of the requests, is to, that railing exists right there right now, is to slide it over so there's a little bit more entry room. Right here, this is very narrow, and to possibly move it over there.
So you're building a larger landing?
A little bit larger landing.
With stairs wider also? Or?
With the stairs being wider.
Yep.
And then for the post detail, this is from the front. This is the exact replica of the front, but would to make a scaled-down version for these two.
At the bottom of the stairs?
At the bottom of the stairs. Something that would wrap and potentially add a couple of the finials that would match the front finials but be smaller in nature.
Doesn't this fence and finial detail continue all the way down past the brick home on the end of Livermore as well?
It does, but if you look at the old photographs, when it came to, like this one doesn't have that there, but what's the house on Market Street that's just been restored? Is it the Langdon?
Oh, not the Moffat Lab. Or the carriage house was restored, or the.
No, the whole front portico, the fencing, the. on Market Street.
Moffat Lab.
The Langdon, man.
Langdon.
On Pleasant Street.
No. This is Market Street.
So you're thinking of the Moffat Lab.
Yeah, Moffat Lodge. So they have a very similar front fence detail. Yeah. There's a house over on Middle Street that has a very similar fence detail, which is also in one of these books. But, you know, we duplicated this, but I think and the owners think that it's a little over the top for that railing detail. We just want to do a couple of nice posts at the start of the entry, and then a little bit more width so that you can have two or three people coming in or out of the doorway and have a place to stand and move through the doorway.
That speaks to Commissioner Kozak's point earlier that in the back of the house certainly would not have the same feel.
Segue into that, though, there's a fire escape ladder that lands on the upper deck. Which was certainly not original, and yes, and that was going to be a question for Roger prior to the meeting, but I'll have to ask him that later. If that could be removed, the construction is such as it's so poorly constructed. I wouldn't want to use it at this point in time.
So these are bedrooms up on the third floor?
One of them is a bedroom, or access to a bedroom. The other is a bathroom.
I'm pretty sure I know what Roger would say about third floor bedrooms. the secondary egress is something that even Portsmouth, which is very lax in their window sizing, something that we should be thankful for in the Historic District Commission. But in third floor bedrooms, it's a whole nother story altogether, and they frequently, you know, require this to be
and
be constructed.
We're certainly aware that there's a question that still needs to be answered about that. But at most, at minimum, it will most likely need to be reconstructed at some point in time, and certainly in a manner that is safer than it exists right now.
Yeah.
So if it's forced to be, one, if it can be done away with, that'd be one request. Two, if it needs to be reconstructed, reconstructed in a manner that you know, meets with the Historic District's certificate of appropriateness, with some changes for sizing, et cetera, that might be required to serve its function of being a fire escape. So prior to the sidewalk, we would find out if that was a requirement from the code enforcement, and then if it is, seek an alternative design.
I would just like to remind you and everybody else that on the sidewalk, it's solely information gathering, no discussion about what may be done or may not be done as appropriate at that time.
Okay. Well, thank you for that clarification. Is there research that further research that I could do on my part with regard to the windows or any other aspect of prior to a sidewalk?
Perhaps photographs of the inside, if we do see original casings or casings of a real age, that
I think
would give a clue to the.
We have to get in here to look. You know, I mean, if I hope that they would allow somebody to go in here and look at this, these, especially the odd window on the third floor, et cetera, you know.
That would be ideal. I would imagine, I mean, who wants the HDC in their house?
I know it. I understand.
But I would say a photograph would suffice. But I agree, Commissioner Wyckoff, going in to see it would be awfully neat. But if it wasn't possible, a photograph would be appropriate.
Okay, there is one other requested item, which is
altering the landing.
Well, the landing for the entry portion.
Mm-hmm.
If you all have that photograph, this is the carriage house portion of the property, which is unit 4. And there's no overhang protection from the elements for this person to enter their house. Throughout Portsmouth, there, and I don't have a drawing to show you of anything proposed, but throughout Portsmouth, there are small, corbelled, bracketed, little hip roofs over a rear entry, or a front entry, for that matter. Throughout Portsmouth, and I'd like to find out if we could add something like that over this doorway.
Here again, that's something that they changed on John Paul Jones' house, the back door. And also, what's quite common is not even a hip roof, it's essentially just an angled board, you know, just a 1x12 coming down with a couple OG brackets underneath it, and you know, that's quite appropriate to an old colonial home.
Is the goal to protect the door, or the landing, or the steps, or was the main goal to protect the door, keep water from?
Well, depending upon what size, you know, when you're fiddling with your keys, and yeah. there's no auxiliary protection there, so just that type of thing.
Because you're right, I thought the same thing that you did, Commissioner Wyckoff.
Which, you know, now that you're, I remember seeing that, I don't know exactly where, but certainly anything.
would help.
The mustard colored house you referenced earlier at Strawberry Bank, I should know the name
Chase,
of the case.
Chase.
I believe they have that detail on the back of the Chase house.
And now that you say it, it's in the cobwebs of my mind that I've definitely seen it, and I'm sure I could find one and propose that as a recommendation.
Jerry Smith's house on South Street and on the driveway side. Jerry and Kathy Smith.
I would suggest that if you see something you think would work and would be appropriate, or even several different things, just take pictures and offer them.
Okay.
What is the, just out of curiosity, I'm seeing a few different things in these renderings. Is this boxy-like structure here versus this? any discussion to be had on any of that?
No, that's the existing condition.
This is?
Yeah. This program wouldn't do that.
Okay. All right.
And so we're not recommending, that back corner is just a cut-up, chopped-up mess.
Gotcha. Is there anything else that you'd like to know from us, or are we pretty much covered this at this point?
No, I think those are the significant pieces. The the function of this interior space is substantially compromised because of the post that sits underneath the dormer, and the dormer can't continue to exist in its present location. And John, you've seen this before, the rafters are all bellied in, they're all troughed towards the dormer itself. Something's got to be done about it.
So do you think this post is actually supporting what would be the carrying beam on the original gambrel? Is that a possibility? Is this post in about 4 feet or so from
the knuckle of the...
Is this post right here?
The post is somewhere close to the knuckle of this.
Way back here?
Yes, but at the... If you're standing at the...
That's not
underneath the ceiling, and the...
So it sits way back from the...
Exactly.
Back
it's,
of the
it's,
house.
It's almost in the middle of the room at the edge of... Like if you were putting a doubler on the edges of the dormant, none exists, and they just stuck a post there, and that's bellied out the floor. And then they put a beam in the kitchen below, and that's bellied out as well. So, yeah, I think it's picking up a substantial portion of the roof as well.
The problem could have been created when some pieces could have been removed when they made this condominium up on the third floor, when they used this small space.
There's a beam running from the front all the way to the back, and I think when they put that dormer in, they just chopped it off, stuck the dormer in, and then 2 months later they said, uh-oh. Mm-hmm.
And what height is that beam? Is that a ceiling?
Well, it's in the ceiling. But
so it's a ceiling joist, it's a collar. It's a collar tie.
Right.
But truly, honestly, the fact is, you have some structural issues that can be repaired, correct? You need some new roof rafters, and you need some new carrying members for those rafters. And it's whether you do whatever dormer style that you want, that you're proposing, you have some major reconstruction to do back here, whichever path you take.
Right.
Okay.
Yes. So if this needs to be preserved, that can be.
We could do that.
Discussed, the existing dormer. Well, maybe having some historic characteristics was certainly not historic. What modifications can be achieved while rebuilding or correcting that is a big portion of the discussion.
As far as windows or things in this thing, is that what you're talking about?
Oh, I didn't even get there yet. We figured we'd come up with the design first and then propose the windows second.
Yeah. Are there two? Do we have a photograph of it? Oh, there's two windows, 2 6/6s there currently in that.
Right.
Yeah. Extension.
Okay.
Yeah, I suppose it's details and sidewalk is the most important thing, because, I mean, I noticed when you're on your drawing here, you do have 9 over 9 windows, and I can see that you're right down on top of this roof with these windows, so you're obviously considering extending these windows down, and...
No, and that's...
Well, I'm just
Yeah, the rendering is just a quick something to show you a possibility for the back of the roof. Okay.
Vice Chair Katz said something earlier, which is very true. You're not going to get any, be able to get any feedback from us on the site visit, which is going to... So the comments you've heard today, you really almost have to, you know, weigh them heavily, because we could put you the site visit, for example, is going to be in a month, is that right?
Well, no,
the request is going to go to Liz, and she's mm-hmm. going to give me the first
we could have possible. A scheduled at any time between now and the next meeting,
which would be both appropriate, timely, and as part of the
But the point is, we can't really give him feedback at that, can we?
Well, are you considering another work session or going straight to public hearing? Or a work session / public hearing?
Yeah, I mean, we'd possibly pursue that as an option with, you know, understanding that we'd like to preserve this historic...
You know, this is a very ambitious project. Are you really thinking of wrapping it up in a month? As far as an approval is concerned?
No, but we'd like to prevent water from continuing to leak into the building.
Sure, sure.
So, and at least, you know, right now we've got 3 or 4 different concepts. We'd like to, you know, narrow that down so that we could come up with measurements and sizes and a recommended window.
What probably will be helpful, all right, is that the commission on the sidewalk can ask questions. You can answer the questions, but it's, and actually you could ask questions, but there's no discussion. You asking questions, I don't know. It's something we'll have to play by
ear. You could look closely at facial expressions.
Yeah, that's true.
I'd recommend that you.
Okay.
We're trying to help you here, because we understand you want to get your approval here, but on this sidewalk, it's not something that is, it's not like this at all. We're fact gathering. It's just the way our ordinance is written. We can't really get into discussion with you because it's not recorded.
That's fine.
Okay. So,
if the focus is on the windows, I think what's appropriate for the windows is to use a good quality new construction window that will fit the fit into the existing casings. And yeah, it's a pain in the neck, but it can be done. We're doing it at Marcy Street. They've been measured extremely carefully, there's a tiny little inside stop that's being replaced on those windows, but all the other features of the interior casings have been preserved for just such a purpose.
So when you say new construction window, then you're talking about a window with a nailing fin around it? That's a new construction window, or are you?
No.
You're not talking about
No, that. Most of the I mean, what we've used at Marcy Street is a new construction window without the casing applied, so that the casing could be put on and match the original.
So it's all workable as it sits, comes out of the package.
The casing parts, yes. So, and there's no nailing fin.
No. So it's a replacement window.
But it's not fitting. Within the existing stock.
So they're coming off the truck with either flat casing or brick mold or something like that, and you remove that?
No, it's not even applied.
It's not even applied.
It's sent loose.
They're sent that way. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So it's a conventional, traditional window, not a thing vinyl coated with fins
No.
Okay.
It's going to be a quality product.
Like any other application, again, we need to reinvent it. He's going to provide the actual spec that shows all these cuts.
That's right.
So, yeah. Yep.
Sure. Well, thank you all for your time.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming in. Good project.
Yeah.
Well, everyone. I guess you can have all of this stuff, huh?
Sure.
I don't know if we should give some to Liz.
Okay, package?
I have
5 minutes break is required.
Oh.
I thought that was a very impassioned presentation, which you wouldn't be able to do.
Welcome back to the Historic District Commission.
Is anyone out there?
We're going to attempt, as we can, to open the elections again. And
are we starting over?
We're starting over.
A point.
Before there's a motion for another person, I wanted to comment on, regardless of who becomes chair next, I think we could do a couple of things for improvement of the board. You know, it's a new year. We should have New Year resolutions to try to make everybody, you know, how we can improve this functioning body. And one thing I ask of the next chair, whoever it is that if we can work on, trying to think of the politically correct way of saying this, and so forgive me if I'm not, is taking turns speaking, not speaking over one another, asking to speak, directing our comments towards the chair. I know it gets frustrating sometimes because, you know, I serve on several different boards and there's different characteristics about each board, which is okay. But there's sometimes you take your turn to speak and you're waiting to be recognized and then someone will interrupt a conversation. So I ask that the body tries to do a better job at that. I know I will try to do a better job at that. And I ask that the chair take a more active role and reining that in if we can. So it's a request for me if we could do that. It's done respectfully. I don't think we do a bad job at it, but I think it'll only make the board function better and appear to the public as a higher functioning body.
Absolutely.
With that,
I'll be
quiet.
It makes a lot of sense.
So we'll reopen this is a question here. Well, we'll just start it from the beginning. We'll reopen the accepting nominations for chairman.
Well, I would nominate Mr. Katz for chair. I've gone over some of the reasons why I think you would be a good chair, and I don't really want to get into a debate. I'm just going to leave it at that.
Yes, Mr. Almeida.
If I could, some of the things that were said earlier tonight about the role of the chair and the role of a voting member, I want to repeat, and I want to speak to even what happened tonight on our applications and our work sessions. When I speak to an application, I have a lot to say about it. I don't want to reserve myself. To cut to the chase, I would be honored to be a vice chair, but I believe that what has been stated earlier tonight, Commissioner Katz would be a fine chair, and I'm afraid that if I were chair at this time, I might have to reserve a lot of emotion and comments that at this time I want to speak, I want to let out into the, you know, the applications. So if there was a scenario where I could be your vice chair, I'd be honored to do that.
I'm sure we can work something out.
Nomination.
Are there any other nominations?
It hasn't been seconded.
We don't second.
Oh, I'm sorry. That's right.
Yeah.
You're right.
Okay.
You're absolutely right.
Once again, are there other nominations?
Call the vote, I guess. Do we vote?
Can we vote? We can. It's the only one, so we can just signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Or nay.
Aye.
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 So we open the nominations for vice chairman.
I nominate Joe Almeida as vice chair.
Are there other nominations? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 We're done. Okay.
Motion to adjourn?
Liz is not going to let us go yet.
Do we have two requests to postpone?
Yeah.
What's that, the work?
Motion to request.
We have before us two requests to postpone.
one is to a time.
To a time not served?
Not served.
That's 30 Maplewood?
30 Maplewood.
I move to postpone 30 Maplewood to next month.
Second.
To a time uncertain.
Time uncertain.
Time uncertain.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Discussion.
So. Abstain. Okay.
And the second one?
Which is 319
Vaughn. Okay. 319 Vaughn, which is the art space application or...
To the February meeting.
Okay, I move to postpone till the February meeting.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Abstain.
I move to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Well, congratulations, Chair and Vice Chair.
Thank you.
You don't get any-